Welcome to Beyond the Data. I'm Dr. Phoebe Thorpe, and here with me today we have two guests, Dr. Martin Meltzer and Dr. Lauren Meyers. In the session today, we heard some about modeling. Most people are familiar with modeling from weather forecasting and predicting hurricanes. Tell us, why is modeling important to public health?
Well, modeling and models are used in many different ways to support public health efforts. And I'll share with you three key applications. So first, there are things in the world that we want to know, but we can't observe them directly. And models allow us to take the data we have, the observations we have, and infer or deduce the things we really want to know. So it's a very simple analogy. Imagine that you want to know how fast a car is driving, but the only pieces of information you have are where it was at noon and where it was at 12:30. So we can take those pieces of information, a very simple equation of motion or a model of motion, and making the assumption that the car was traveling at a constant speed, we can take those pieces of data and infer the speed of the car in miles per hour. Well, the same thing happens in outbreaks. We want to know something like the transmission rate of the disease, but all we can see is how many cases there are this week, how many cases there were last week, maybe last month. And so we can take those pieces of data and use the models we have, more complex than equation of motion that include in them how diseases transmit, fit those kinds of models to that kind of data to infer what we want to know, the transmission rate of the disease. The second way in which we use models is for forecasting and for nowcasting. Sometimes in the early outbreak situation, it's very hard to get reliable real-time data from the front line, but we really want to know how contagious is the disease, how fast is it spreading, or other important quantities. With good models, we can get a good sense. We can estimate what's going on the ground now and maybe even anticipate what's going to happen next week or next month. And finally, we use models all the time to support good decision making. How do we use our limited public health resources to save lives, to mitigate outbreaks? And models allow us to do the kinds of experiments we can't do in the real world. We would like to be able to do controlled experiments to figure out if we only have a small number of vaccines, who should we give them to in order to save the most lives. But we may not have time to do that in an outbreak situation. It may be unethical. We may not have the resources to do it. So models allow to conduct those kinds of experiments virtually so we can use our resources in the most efficient, effective way possible.
That's a very interesting point about using the data efficiently, because in your presentation you talk about taking social media data and molecular data from the disease and combining it into modeling to figure out where the disease is spreading. How did you do that? How did you take the data and the expertise and make it into a model?
Yeah, well, this is a very exciting time in terms of data for modeling. Whereas we used to only use sort of more traditional public health surveillance data, now we have all these cool new 21st century big data sources at our disposal. There's people tweeting, there's people putting Facebook posts, et cetera, about how they feel. There are now volumes of electronic medical records becoming available that we can use to really get a better understanding of how outbreaks spread. So we are, as a community, a very interdisciplinary community that includes scientists and social scientists and engineers and statisticians and particularly public health professionals. We are, as a community, getting together, trying to combine our expertise, use flexible statistical models that allow us to pull different kinds of information from different data sources to really get the best understanding, the best picture we can of where diseases are spreading around the world and how we might be able to better contain them.
That's a lot of combining, and it sounds like there's a lot of steps in the process. What do you think is the most important step or the most important part?
The most important step is the first step. And this is a step that's done in close collaboration between scientists like me and the public health professionals, the people at the front line. And that step is articulating what is the problem you want to solve. What is the problem that is relevant to public health where models can actually make a difference, where models can provide guidance that will lead to better outcomes for our populations? And it is through deep probing conversations with public health partners that we're able to not only articulate the problem, but we're able to build models that are realistic and that produce outputs that are interpretable and actionable for public health.
Yeah, and that was the other question I had about the models. I just wonder, how do you reach the level where you feel like they're accurate?
Yeah, well, to be candid, sometimes we never know for sure that our model is right, particularly when you're talking about a disease or you're modeling a population where you just have very little experience and very little data. Nonetheless, we take lots of steps to ensure the reliability, to build confidence in our model. One, as a large community of modelers that stretches the globe, we try as much as possible to compare notes. We build different kinds of models using different kinds of data, but often attacking the same kind of problems. How is Ebola spreading? How can we contain it? And by comparing notes, by comparing our models, our results, our assumptions, we're able to build confidence in what we're finding. Yeah.
Yeah, it sounds like it's a lot of collaboration, a lot of little steps here and there, and bringing it all together to make the predictions right.
Yeah, and there are other steps we do take as well. As individual modelers, if we're building models using data, often we'll set aside half of the data, mm-hmm. build our model, do our analysis, and then come back to that data we've set aside and make sure what we're finding is actually consistent with the data. Mm-hmm. And the last thing we do is we often, when we're modeling for decision support, when we're trying to give public health partners some actionable guidance, what we'll do is we'll do what we call sensitivity analysis, and we'll try to come up with robust recommendations that are going to be good even if the assumptions, even if the inputs in our model weren't exactly right or actually a little bit different.
Ah, okay. So a little bit of thinking through of like disaster, if something goes wrong kind of idea.
Exactly.
Yeah. Thank you very much for joining us, Lauren.
Thank you.
And thank you. Next will be Dr. Martin Meltzer. We just heard from Dr. Lauren Meyers, and now with us is Dr. Martin Meltzer, a modeler here at CDC. Martin, thank you for joining us.
My pleasure, Phoebe.
In the session today, we heard about the predictions for Ebola and that the models were within 23% of the reported cases. That's remarkably accurate. Mm-hmm. How did you know when the model had reached that level of reliability and accuracy?
Well, actually, to get to the point where we knew it was on 23%, we had to wait till the event, and that was actually January the 20th, 2015, and actually passed. But the most important thing for decision makers and policy makers is not how accurate it is 6 months ahead of the prediction, but is it reliable in terms of, is the model suggesting and providing information that points the policymakers in the correct direction? That is, what would happen if we don't intervene, and what would happen if we intervene? Is the model's estimates, are they in the general direction upon which policymakers can make the right kind of decisions that will result in the outcomes that we want? Exact accuracy is not the name of the game.
Okay, so you worked with both the Ebola response and the H1N1 pandemic.
Indeed.
What other lessons did you learn from that?
Well, I think the most important thing, as Dr. Richard Hatchett, who is also on our panel today, mentioned, was sometimes the most important thing about the modeling isn't the exact number, but the discussion between the modelers who are trying to build a system without all the data and all the known points, and what the policymakers, what are their questions that they want, and how much can we provide some estimates of those, and how much do the policymakers really understand how little we might know, or as I like to put it, how thin is the ice upon which they are skating when they're making decisions? Can we help them fully appreciate that? Sometimes the most important thing is not what we know, but what don't we know, and do we really understand that?
And that also came up in our session today was transparency and how that's
Absolutely.
Very, very important to modeling and to the decision-making process. And also widely disseminated models. Can you tell us about the importance of transparency and how you would disseminate those models?
Absolutely. Particularly decision makers, policy makers, they are human. And they have to make a lot of very important decisions under a great deal of pressure. So it is illogical in my mind to expect them to take in very complicated models that have all the bells and whistles, I call it like Christmas trees with all the ornaments attached, to understand that. In the meantime, they're also getting a lot of information from other sources and absorb a very complicated model and use that for decision making. What they can absorb is a simple model that they can readily understand, or some of their helpers understand and tell them, yes, we understand the elements in the model. It might not capture everything about the disease transmission and the impact of the interventions, but it gives us a general picture. And a general picture helps them get a little bit further down the road when they have to make a decision. So transparency is a greatly appreciated currency when you're having that conversation between modeler and decision maker.
And what I think I hear you saying is that the basically you're trying to help the decision makers understand that if X changed, this would happen to Y and how it will change the overall prediction.
Absolutely correct. And indeed, some of the ways that we get them, the decision makers and their teams, to really understand it is produce simple models. I prefer very often spreadsheets, because you can hand the spreadsheet, much like a calling card, to them and say, you don't trust our numbers? That's okay. Enter your own numbers and see what happens. And that's that the ability, sometimes they don't even do it, but just knowing that they can do that gets them understanding a great deal of what the model does and does not do, and greatly increases the confidence that at least whatever numbers we produce, they can feel certain they understand how those numbers are produced.
And Lauren talked some about how important it is to involve other modelers and other people who are working on the same project, and that gets to the widely disseminated point. How do you work on that? How do you incorporate beyond just the CDC folks into the modeling?
It is indeed a challenge, but one of the ways that we've done it in the past and will continue in the future, because it's had so much success, is that once we produce a model, because it's in a spreadsheet, we post it on the internet. And anybody, and that means literally anybody, can download and play with, including, and this has happened, people in the media, students, just the general public, and indeed policymakers have their teams download it, and we get questions. What do we mean when we put that number in? And when we get those questions, I know we've at least crossed some of that bridge in terms of communicating what the model does and does not do.
Where, if someone was interested in going and looking at some of the models that you've produced, where would you direct them to go?
The CDC website, the particular model name, or just even something like Ebola model in the search engine should find you to it. Or if they want, they can send us an email and we will be able to direct them to the website where they can download it.
Where would they send the email?
To my email address, which is on the CDC website associated with this talk.
Okay, all right. And I think we have some models too on our website if they
Indeed.
Wanted to go there too.
Wide variety of models, yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
And thank you for joining us, and we'll see you next time on Beyond the Data.